Good morning, and a very warm welcome to our service of Holy Communion this morning. A special welcome if you're visiting with us for the first time today. We're delighted that you could join us, and perhaps you're new to us on the live stream or our YouTube channel as well. So we're delighted that you could join us for this service. And we'll start our service with the sentence of scripture and the response. Welcome in the name of Christ. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
And we've got a couple of notices at this stage, things we thought you'd like to hear about or be involved in. And the first is that Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And over the centuries, Christians have been celebrating that victory over darkness and evil on All Saints Day, which is tomorrow, the 1st of November. And on the holy evening before All Saints Day, or Halloween, over the centuries, we had celebrations of that victory over darkness, a vigil to prepare us for that All Saints Day, and perhaps a few tricks and games to symbolise that victory over evil. Now, Halloween has become a bit changed over the years, and we're going back to the traditional version, which is a light party. And this evening at 4 o'clock, Tom Watson, our youth worker, will be leading us, leading a large group of young kids, all in Key Stage 1 and 2, and their parents, in a light party. So that's going to be great. And if you'd like to take part in that, there's probably still an opportunity to do that if you get in touch with Tom. And this week, we'll be having our monthly central prayer meeting, which is a great opportunity to pray together for the community, for the church, and for the world. It only takes an hour. It's on Zoom, and it's broken out into small groups. You don't have to pray out loud. If you don't want to, you can join in the prayers quietly, or you can say as much as you like. It's entirely up to you, but it's good to hear from people and what their prayer needs are for the school, for our young people, and all sorts of vital topics for us. And the big community breakfast is taking place next Saturday morning. All are welcome. And it's a great opportunity for us to work together with the community, to use the chapel, to be part of our community, and bring people together, all sorts of different people across the area. And that's taking place next week. There's a team of helpers already organised, but do just come along if you're able to next Saturday morning. And finally, and most importantly, Tom and Lizzie Watson have had their baby. It's a baby boy. Mother and a little chap are doing brilliantly, and they've had a few issues, but it's great news. He doesn't have a name yet, but we're watching this space. So fantastic news, and what a precious gift of a little brother for Darcy. And we'll just pray for them now. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for all that Tom and Lizzie and Darcy do in the community, bringing light into our world. And we just thank you that Tom is so dedicated to that. He's held off his paternity leave to be running the light party this evening. We just pray for the family to have that break now. Surround them with your love and peace and health. And just protect them over the next few weeks as they get used to being a bigger family, Lord, and all that that brings. And we just pray for this young man and all that life will hold for him. And we just pray above all else that you would be a shining presence within his life. In Jesus' name, amen. And we'll continue with our prayer of preparation, which we'll say together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. And we'll continue by standing to sing our opening hymn, When Morning Gilds the Skies. Confession. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. And there's a response for us as we go through each stage of the confession. For turning away from you and ignoring your will in our lives, Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. For behaving just as we wish, without thinking of you, Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. For failing you by what we do and think and say, Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. For living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son, Father, forgive us. Save us and help us. May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring us to his pardon and peace, now and forever.
Amen.
And we'll continue with our worship and we'll stand to sing. The young people are leaving at this stage, are they?
Yeah.
Or have they all already gone? This is a, off they go. And we'll just pray for them now. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for our young people's work and for all that this means to them in bringing the light of the world into their lives. Be with them now and their leaders, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
for our reading.
Reading from 2 Peter 3, verses 1 to 13. The Day of the Lord. Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I have written both of them as a reminder to stimulate you to the wholeness of thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and Saviour through your apostles. Above all, you must understand that in the last days scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, "Where is this coming he promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation." But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's words, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I didn't worry Paul then, I wasn't quite sure when the sermon came. Good morning to you all. Unless you've been somewhere in outer space for the last week or two, you'll be very aware that today in Glasgow, COP26 begins. If you didn't, you will over the next week or so. Of little else. Took 25,000 people, together with most of the world's leaders, a meeting, as we know, to try to find a way to protect the future of the planet and of humankind. What future? Today there are millions of people homeless through conflict. There are millions of people living under oppression. Others are persecuted, some even to death. There's corruption in the world and greed. There's terrorism. There's awful poverty. There's hatred. Even our governments have had to pass laws to try to suppress hatred. What kind of future is there for humankind? What kind of future is there for the planet? I turn to science. Over the last year or so, we've followed the science to some extent. I looked to Brian Cox, most of you will know him, very popular presenter of BBC programmes on the cosmos. I like him. He's very enthusiastic and incredibly graphic in his descriptions. And I don't know about you, but when I watch those things and see the magnitude of what's out there, the precision, the whole wonder of it, I just think he's glorifying God. He'd be horrified. He's a humanist. He believes that humankind are the highest form of life. However, what he says about the future is this. He said, this earth will continue for trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions and trillions of years before it dies. Now, I hope you counted all that. It may as well be forever. So we needn't worry. But what does God say about the future? What does God say? And Peter, in the passage we had read to us, gives us a good picture. Peter, well, he's not really a professor like Brian Cox, who's a professor of astrophysics. He's very, very intelligent. Peter is a fisherman. Probably had no formal education. However, we need to think a bit further. Peter actually had 3 years full-time 24/7 education with God incarnate. Is there anything to match that? Anyway, Peter was on the Mount of Transfiguration when God's voice came down and said, this is my dear son. I'm well pleased with him. Peter was at the cross, the crucifixion. It's probably a little way away, but it wasn't a good time for him at all. But he saw his Lord die. Peter was one of the first at the empty tomb, the resurrection. And there was no doubt about it because he then met Jesus, the risen Jesus, talked with him, ate food that Jesus cooked. Last of all, Peter was there with the disciples when Jesus ascended into heaven. And he heard the angel, one of the two angels who was there, saying, this same Jesus. In the same way who's ascended into heaven today will return the same way. Peter, very clear about the future. Jesus is coming. But he begins the passage we're considering by urging believers to recall, to bring to mind the things they've heard, the things they've heard from the prophets, which we know as the Old Testament, and the things they've heard from Jesus through the apostles, which is the New Testament. Bring to mind the scripture that you've heard, because there's trouble ahead. You want to safeguard yourselves against false teachers. It was about 40 years into the early church, which started vigorously, was now still growing, but false teachers began to appear. And Peter was so anxious they should know about his future that he wanted them to be ready to combat that false teaching. Hope in the coming of Jesus has sustained these people through years of persecution. They'd had a rough time, and all the time in their minds was, Jesus is coming back. He's coming back. One day, things are going to change. But now, scoffers had come. People who scoffed at the very idea. Where is this coming, he promised, they said. 40 years have gone. Nothing's happened. Nothing's still happened. Give up thinking about it. Not even 40 years, but going back to the beginning of time, nothing has changed. God has changed nothing. Why will he now? Why will he come? Doubt. Doubt. Doubt is a devastatingly clever tool of Satan. Do you remember in the Garden of Eden how he came to Eve? Did God really say, you shan't eat of that fruit? Did he really say it? Is that what he meant? Surely you wouldn't die. Surely you won't die if you eat it. No, it's a fruit. Doubt, doubt. And so he comes to us. I doubt there's one in this room, one believer, who hasn't had doubts. Many, many. It's Satan's greatest ploy. Something goes badly wrong. Is God in this? Is God allowing this? Does God care? All manner of things in life come along. Doubt, doubt is so. Peter says to them, bring to mind the scriptures, the things you've learned. The things you've learned about God. Bring them to mind when these times come. Peter goes on to say that these scoffing people deliberately forgot the things that they learned, the things that they'd heard. They deliberately forgot them. It was inconvenient. It threatened their way of life, which wasn't wholly in accord with God's laws and God's will. So they dismissed it. Unhappily, that's been the case through the generations to this day. People in the wider church, theologians, clergy, forget or reject. Some even reject anything that's supernatural, as though God wasn't supernatural. It's hard to believe. Others change, deliberately forget, or alter, or modify the scriptures. And sometimes it looks very attractive because it lets you do things that you might not do otherwise. God's word is true and is essential for us, for our well-being and for our hope. And here we're talking about hope. Peter says they deliberately forget God's great power in creation, as by his word the heavens and the earth were brought into being. I think there's no other thing that speaks to us of the power, the majesty, the beauty of God than creation. It's always hard to picture the wonder of him, but that's the best. These people had dismissed him. He's not going to keep his promise. Perhaps he can't. And Peter says, they said everything's continued since the beginning, but they're wrong. We've just been looking through Genesis not long ago. Noah, look at that period. God looked down and he saw the wickedness of men and women. It was dreadful. And he intervened and sent the flood. And only Noah and those with him were saved. The same word Peter says that created the heavens and the earth, this heavens and earth, the same power will one day end it. Will one day end it. I wish well for the climate change folk to succeed, but the world won't end by climate change. It will end when God says it will end. He will end it. The present heavens and the earth will end. Day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. These are not pleasant things to talk about, but this is God's word and this is God's plan. Peter explains the delay. It was 40 years, then it's 2,000 years now. And it rather makes the point, because he said, God isn't slow. He's not limited. God is patient. God is patient. He's not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. This loving, caring God is holding back his plan. Every day is another day when he's patient. It should make us more diligent in our evangelism. God wants people to come to himself, and he's holding on, and he's giving us days and days and days. Everyone should be precious to us and sharing our faith. But the day of the Lord will come. Peter says, it's so. Jesus said it. The Old Testament said it. It will come. Come like a thief in the night. Come without warning. Burglars don't send you an email. I'm coming on Tuesday. Yeah, come back a thief in the night. And Peter issues us with a challenge. Seeing that Jesus is coming any time, seeing that everything in this world that's been done is to be destroyed, what kind of people ought you to be? This is his challenge to believers. What kind of people ought you to be? Well, Peter helpfully answers his own question. You should be living holy and godly lives. Now that's a high bar for all of us. We know living a holy and godly life. We know what it means more or less, although the word holy has had a bad press through the years. People tend to think of it as being sanctimonious, or a monk or a nun or some such a person. It really means separate. And in this case, it means separate to God. Once we were separate from God, and Jesus came, now we're separate to God. That's exactly what it means. It means God has the priority. God's will has the priority in our lives. It means being pleasing to God. It means being like Jesus. Easy to say, more difficult to copy. Many years ago, more than 60, in a chapel in West London that I attended as a Sunday school and church, we had an itinerant preacher on Sunday. We had a number of these men who went from church to church as needed. A little bit like lay readers, I suppose. Many of them were very godly men and very dear. I don't remember this man much. I don't remember his sermon. I think it must have been on this subject, because I don't know what I was doing at the time. I hope I was listening, but I just remember there was a silence. He had stopped and he said, "I want you all, in your imagination, now, this moment, to think that there's a great disturbance outside this church. Wind and thunder and lightning. And the door opens and Jesus comes in." He comes to the front and he stands and looks at you all. How comfortable would you feel? How ready would you be to meet him? You know, that just stuck with me. I can't say it did at the time. I can't say that I spent my life remembering it. I haven't. It just came back to me the other day. But it's worth thinking about. Would we be pleased? Yes, we'd be pleased. Would we be comfortable? We should always be prepared, is what Peter's saying. In the first chapter of this letter, Peter gives us a bit of guidance. He says, God has given us everything we need for life and godliness through Jesus. Through Jesus, we have everything we need. And by his precious promises, we can participate in the divine nature. Now that's an incredible statement, particularly that last phrase, participate in the divine nature, be more like Jesus. It can be done, and it's done through the promises of God and God's word. We need to attend on these things. It's not an intellectual thing. Not many wise, Paul says among you. Not saying that here, you're all wise, I know. But we just need to attend. The word of God is active and alive. We just need to come to it and read it. It talks to us. The Holy Spirit is active. We can be ready. We need to be ready. We should always live. I haven't heard this preached in many, many years, but we should all live in the knowledge that Jesus could come the next 5 minutes. I wonder if there's anyone here who's not a believer. God is patient, he's kind, and he's merciful. But he will judge those who reject his offer of salvation in Jesus Christ. He will. And he's patient, and he's allowing time now. But he won't wait forever. Think about it. When you give in to his loving call, while there is still time. What does God say about the future? God says, Jesus is coming. That's the future. Peter says, the end of that passage, in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. No more corruption, no more greed, no more hatred, no more grief, no more suffering. What will it be like? I can go no better place than Scripture itself. I'm reading from the book of Revelation. This is the Apostle John. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. And there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. That's you, the church. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the older things have passed away. worked two shifts after that. A little later, I did not see a temple in the city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. On no day will its gates ever be shut, for there is no night there. The glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I pray you can be sure, each one of us, that our name is written in that book, that we can look forward with hope to the coming of Jesus again. May he aid us as we seek to be ready for him. Amen.
Stands to sing our next song.
Father God, we were
worship and adore you, come before you in adoration and praise for who you are and for life itself. Thank you that we are gathered in your presence and in your name, and that we can bring our petitions to you this morning, knowing that you hear us and that you love each one of us more than we can ever comprehend. We confess that we are not spotless, blameless, and at peace with ourselves, as in the reading this morning, but we are assured that you long for us to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour. We ask for more revelation by your Holy Spirit, that we may grow in unity and love for one another, and set our hearts upon an eternal future with you. We give thanks for the vaccination programme and all the scientists, medics and volunteers who have worked to keep us safe in the pandemic. We pray for those families who have lost loved ones to this disease. May they be comforted in their grief. We pray for the doctors, nurses and all those working within the NHS at this time under such pressure and difficulty. We pray for those within our congregation who are involved with caring for patients, and we pray that they may remain well, strong and courageous in the face of the daily, unending workload. We also give thanks for our school, the head teacher, Sarah Lakey, and all the staff and children at the school. We pray that as they return to the classroom next week, that they would be protected from the virus and would remain well during this term. We pray for wisdom for Mrs. Lakey as she makes difficult decisions day by day. We pray for wise counsel for her, and we pray for the governors of the school. May the children be kept safe and inspired to learn, and especially receptive to Christian teaching within the school. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for Elizabeth our Queen and her long reign. We pray for her that she may be strengthened day by day to carry out the duties which face her. We pray for good health and courage as she continues to faithfully serve this nation. We pray for our leaders and government, especially praying for wisdom and an understanding of the needs of the poor in this country. May decisions made at the COP26 summit be carried through and result in reaching targets set. We pray for all those world leaders who have real power to protect the planet from global warming. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we remember the people of Afghanistan and their suffering. We pray for women who need to work to support families, yet are not allowed to work. We pray for girls to rightfully receive a suitable education. We pray for wisdom for those who make decisions as to whether to grant aid to the Taliban government. May justice be done. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, we pray for the sick and the bereaved. We pray for those we know who are suffering illness, bereavement, or loneliness at this time. We ask that they be comforted in their distress, praying for healing of mind, body, and spirit. And in a moment of quiet, we bring them before you now. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
We come now to the peace part of our service, and the peace has been a bit of a casualty of the COVID pandemic, with us not being able to share the peace properly, and it's been a tradition in this church to share God's peace with everyone in the congregation as part of the preparation for our communion service. So we'll do the best we can, and if you'd like to stand, we'll share the peace together. Now, not quite sure how this is done, but do wave or smile or turn around and greet in whatever way is appropriate those around you. But Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body on his cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be with you.
I'm giving him a thumbs up. Yeah.
And as the young people return, we'll continue with our communion service.
Please be seated. Just wait for the final few youngsters to come and gives me an opportunity to say good morning to you all. I've not had a chance to do that yet. Good morning, it's good to see you. We welcome to the Lord's table all who believe and trust in Jesus, all who through the Lord have their names written in his book of life, all because of his work and not because of ours. And although we are unworthy, God invites us to share around his table as his family. So we do invite everyone to come up to the front if you would like to. Please wait for the sides people to direct you. And then if you come up in a single file, receive a wafer from me in the centre, then move either to your left or your right to dip the wafer in the wine and then back to your seats. We do encourage people to wear masks as they move around during communion. But of course, remove it in order to take the wafer. Wine. If you would rather just sit quietly in your pew, please don't feel embarrassed if the size people come and you just ask them or indicate that you'll stay where you are. Well, as we come to the Lord's table, we begin with some responses. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy at all times and in all places to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For he is our great High Priest, who has loosed us from our sins and made us to be a royal priesthood to you, our God and Father. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with the whole company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave me thanks. He gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit. Inspire us with your love and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one mind. So draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts, by faith, with thanksgiving. If I can invite those who are helping with communion and the musicians to come and receive that, please. Let's join together in the words of the prayer after communion. We pray together.
Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to us. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in that hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
We've been reminded this morning from 2 Peter about the return of Jesus, and our final hymn picks up on that theme. Lo, he comes with clouds descending. Let's stand as we sing our final hymn together.
Thank you.
Lord Jesus, everlasting God, come down. Well, as we finish with the prayer, can I invite you just to sit? Just a quick look at Bruno, then people to pray afterwards. There are, if there's anything that you would value prayer for, things that you'd like to pray about, we will have a few folk in Drake's Chapel to my left, your right. And if you'd like to pray about anything, they'd be delighted to pray with you and for you, whether it's something that has been challenging from what we've heard this morning, whether there are other things going on, we'd be delighted to pray with you and for you. So please do make use of that at the end of the service if you'd like to. Everything, of course, taken in that complete confidence. Well, as we come to the end of our service, can I remind you, next week we finish off 2 Peter, so don't miss it, the last part of 2 Peter chapter 3 at our all-age service. But as we close now, let's do so with some words from 1 Thessalonians as our final prayer. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it.
Amen.
Amen. So let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.